Tonight, we are going to start looking at what we call the seven seals. But I gotta tell you something. If you're planning to come tonight and not come tomorrow night, my, that is not going to be good, because actually this presentation will follow with tomorrow's presentation. So please do make tomorrow night, because tonight is going to be good, but tomorrow is going to be better. Amen? But tonight we have this very important topic to talk about, and I call it Unsealing the Seven Seals. So let me show you what we're going to do tonight. Now you know that Book of Revelation has 22 chapters, and I already shared with you the whole outline of the book. The beginning part covers the seven churches and seven seals, seven trumpets, and the war between the church and the dragon, and the judgment against Babylon, and the coming of Jesus, and new heaven and new earth. Now, tonight, we're covering seven seals. So, as you can see, that is right after the seven churches. So this is how it begins. Chapter 4, chapter 5, chapter 6, and chapter 7. And if you like details, it actually goes all the way to chapter 8 and verse 1. I don't know why the chapters were divided that way, but that's just the way they were divided. But anyhow, so the actual seven seals are mentioned in chapter 6. But then we have this great chapter, chapter 4 and chapter 5. So you have to understand a little bit of background before we get into chapter 6. Now in chapter 4, obviously we don't have time to go into all the verses, but I just want to let you know that Revelation chapter 4 is about the throne of God. What did I just say? Throne of God. Just to give you a little glimpse. Here we have, in verse 2, the Bible says, "And immediately I was in the Spirit, and behold, a throne was set in heaven, and one sat on the throne. And he that sat was to look upon like jasper and sardine stone, and there was a rainbow around about the throne, in sight like unto an emerald. And round about the throne were 24 seats, and upon the seats I saw 24 elders sitting, clothed in white raiment, and they had on their heads gold crowns of gold." So imagine, so here we have in chapter 4, the Bible gives us this incredible picture of the throne of God, how there was this rainbow above his head, and then there were angels around him. Other seats, and the Bible calls them 24 elders. As far as I can study, I believe there are angels as well. So imagine how big, vast, magnificent this throne of God is like. So that's chapter 4. And then chapter 5. Chapter 5, verse 1 begins with this idea. "And I saw in the right hand of him," meaning right hand of God, and God the Father is sitting in his throne. "I saw in the right hand of him that sat on the throne a book written within and on the backside, sealed with" what? "Seven seals." So imagine God the Father in his throne, in his hand, he has this book. Now, in English translation, the Bible says book, but really we're talking about scrolls, okay? So imagine like rolled up scrolls, okay? So God has this book, all right, in his hand, and the Bible says it has what? How many seals? Seven seals. Now, what is this all about? Well, just to let you know, the Bible itself does not tell us exactly what is contained in that book. However, based upon the seals, we can get a pretty good idea what is in the book. So, even though we may not understand all the details about this mysterious book with seven seals, what is important is who is able to open this book. And according to the Bible, in verse 2, it says, "And I saw a strong angel proclaiming with a loud voice." And then, "Who is worthy to open the book and to loose the seals thereof?" You see, ladies and gentlemen, in the Bible, okay, or in heaven, when angels ask questions, it's not because they don't know. In the Bible, there are many places where angels ask questions. It's not like they don't know the answer. They already know the answer. Why are they asking? They're asking not for themselves, but for the one that is seeing the vision. Who was seeing the vision? John the Beloved, one of the disciples of Jesus Christ. For his sake, for his understanding, these angels like to ask questions. Believe me, angels in heaven, they really don't have to go, "God, please, can you answer my question? I have no idea what's going on." No, they know, because God communicates with them and God tells them. So this angel is asking the question, "Who is worthy to open the book and to loose the seals thereof?" Now let me ask you something. In order to open this book, how many seals do you have to break? Seven seals. And each seal, when you break it, something happens. It's like giving you a preview, a glimpse, an idea what is in the book. Now, so the question is, who is able to open this amazing book? And then the Bible says in verse 5, "And one of the elders saith unto me, Weep not." You see, because of time, I cannot read all the verses, but the Bible speaks about how John the Revelator, he looked around to see who is worthy to open the book, but there was no one that can open the book. So he began to weep. He began to cry. I have to say, John can be an emotional guy. You know, he's a prophet of God, a man of God, but he can be emotional. And he becomes emotional because he is so concerned about the church on earth, the believers on earth. And he can see that this book has the answers to all the questions and the challenges and all the problems that the people on earth are facing, the believers, the followers of Jesus Christ. So he wants to know. No one can open this book. He began to weep, but the elder said, "Weep not. The Lion of the tribe of Judah, the Root of David, has prevailed to open the book and loose the seven seals thereof." Ah, so there is someone there who can open this book. Who? The Lion of the tribe of Judah and the Root of David. Now, who is he? And the very next text, verse 6, it says, "And I beheld." See, he heard the answer. Oh, the Lion of the tribe of Judah. Okay, and then the Bible says, "And I beheld." I look to see. Basically, I look to see who can open the book. Bam. When he looked at it, he said, "I beheld, and lo, in the midst of the throne and of the four beasts and in the midst of the elders stood," pay attention, "a lamb as it had been slain." Who is that? Jesus. Now, listen very carefully, okay? This is very important. You cannot miss this. So pay attention. You already know in the book of Revelation, we have many different descriptions of Jesus, right? Okay? When Jesus is described as, for example, if he's described as I am the one with the two-edged sword. Sword. If Jesus described with the sword, and you know in the Bible, sword represents what? Word of God. When Jesus present himself with the sword, that means the people that he is talking to, they need the word of God. Are you with me? If Jesus present himself as high priest, that means the people need a high priest. If Jesus present himself as mighty angel, that means they need a mighty messenger. What am I trying to say? According to the Bible, Jesus presents himself to a certain situation or a certain time to a certain group of people according to their need. Say amen. So if you need a father, he will come to you as a father. If you need a friend, he will come to you as a friend. If you need a protector, he will come to you as a bodyguard. Okay? So Jesus knows how to adapt according to your need. Now, before we get into the seven seals, all right? Notice the way Jesus is being presented. Jesus could have revealed himself in many different fashions, yes? Therefore, John could have looked at Jesus in other fashions. For example, he could have said, I beheld, and lo, in the midst of the throne, of the four beasts, in the midst of the elders, stood humongous rock. If Jesus presented himself as a rock, that means we need Jesus as our foundation. Are you following? But he is presented as a lamb as it had been what? Slain. Now, that is very important. Why? Listen. Stood. What does that mean, stood? I'm sorry. This is English 101. Okay? Stood. What does that mean? Basically standing. Who is standing? Lamb, but as it had been what? Slain. The word slain means what? Another word for slain? Killed. So then this lamb was killed, but now it is standing. So what does that mean? The lamb was killed, but now is standing. So what's the idea? It's alive. But then it was dead. So according to the Bible, when someone dies and when someone comes back from the death, okay, what do we call that? Resurrection. Resurrection. What did I just say? Resurrection. So when the Bible says, stood a lamb as it had been slain, it's just simply saying, Jesus standing there as the one that got what? Resurrected. Why? Because what we're about to see in seven seals, the people in seven seals, they need Jesus as the one that has a power to resurrect. Exactly. It can be a little bit complicated, but if you really look into it, it is very simple. Okay? And it's very important. In fact, this title of Jesus being the one that has the power of resurrection, or the resurrected one, it was already given to us in chapter 1 and verse 5. Check this out. And this is important. It says, and from Jesus Christ, the first begotten of the what? Dead. See that? First begotten of the dead. Huh, what does that mean, first begotten of the dead? It just simply means, okay, he is the first one that, he was the first one that got what? Resurrected. And some of you are asking the question, raising your hands, mentally speaking, oh, Brother Gregory, what about Moses? He got resurrected before Jesus did. What about that one? Even Lazarus, he got resurrected before Jesus got resurrected. Then why is he called the first born, first begotten of the dead? It's very simple. You guys ready? Jesus is called the first begotten of the dead, not because he was the first one got resurrected, but in order to have any other resurrections, you have to have the resurrection of Jesus. So Moses could not have been resurrected if Jesus, if he wasn't resurrected. You with me? So Moses got resurrected with the promise that Jesus someday will die and be resurrected. So in that sense, for preeminent sense, he is considered the first begotten of the dead. But in fact, this topic, it goes even deeper. You guys ready for this? Okay, so pay attention. Now, he is called the first begotten. But what's interesting is this. Do you remember John chapter 3, verse 16? For God so loved the world that he gave his what? Only begotten Son. So when Jesus came to this world, he came to this world as what? Only begotten. But then when Jesus got resurrected, and Jesus Christ, the first begotten. Now, when he got resurrected, he is called the first begotten. Let me ask you something. Only begotten and first begotten, are they the same? Yes or no? Are you confused? When I say, if I say, this is my only begotten Son versus this is my first begotten Son, are they the same? Yes or no? Okay, let me put it this way. This is my only Son. This is my first Son. Are they the same? Yes or no? This is my only Son. This is my first Son. Okay, let me ask you this way. This is my only Son. How many sons do I have? Thank you. Selamat Paul. If I say this is my first Son, how many sons do I have? More than one. Thank you. Thank you. More than one, right? If it's not more than one, why would you say first son, first child? Yeah? Do you go around saying, hey, this is my first child, but you only have one child? I mean, where do you have your other children? Where do you have your other children? Yeah? You understand what I'm talking about? Yeah? So then, look at this. When Jesus came to this world, it's like God gave only begotten Son. But then when Jesus got resurrected, now he is considered first begotten. Why? Let's look into this a little more. In Acts chapter 13, Acts 13 verse 33, the Bible says this, God has fulfilled the same unto us, their children, in that he has, what? Raised up Jesus again, meaning resurrection, yes or no? Okay, resurrection. As it is also written in the second Psalm, listen, thou art my Son, this day have I what? Begotten thee. So, you know what was happening? When Jesus got resurrected, that day, God the Father said to his Son, this day have I begotten thee. It's like when Jesus got resurrected, it was his new birth. And the womb, yeah? A new birth, you gotta have a womb, yes? And the womb was the tomb. Okay? So when Jesus came out, God said, this day have I begotten thee, and now you are the first begotten. Oh, what's the big deal? It's very simple. When God the Father gave up his son, he gave up his only begotten son. You understand? But then when Jesus died and when he came out of the grave, now he changed to first begotten. Why? Because he is now forever human. 100% God, at the same time, 100% human. But he's not called the only begotten. Why? What is God trying to say? Anybody who believes you, Jesus, anybody who believes you, I'm going to consider them to be second begotten, third begotten, fourth begotten, fifth begotten, sixth begotten. Say amen out there. Do you understand? That's why when we believe in Jesus, Jesus is our elder brother. So, putting everything together, when the Bible says, stood a lamb as it had been slain, what does that mean? I am what? Resurrected. And at the same time, I want to make other people to be what? To be part of my family. To produce the second begotten and the third begotten and on and on and on and on. That's why we, in the book of Romans, that the Bible says we join heirs of Christ. Now, with that understanding, we move on. All right? Because something about resurrection, something about making us his children, all that is involved in the seven seals. So after Jesus was mentioned, here we have angels in heaven. The Bible says, and I beheld and I heard the voice of many angels round about the throne and the beasts and the elders, and the number of them was how many? 10,000 times what? 10,000 and thousand of thousands. I'm sure this is only an expression of many, 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 many angels. But one day I decided, because I am Korean, I like to calculate, yeah, math, yes, Asian. So one time I sat down and calculate how many angels by taking those numbers literally. So 1,000 times 1,000, 10,000 times 10,000. It came out to be, I believe, 100 billions. Do you know what it's like to have 100 billion angels? Most likely that's a figurative number, but if we take that literally, 100 billion angels. So I was imagining, what kind of auditorium do I need in order to hold 100 billion angels? How much space do we need? Maybe 2 feet by 2 feet, yeah? But angels, you know, have you heard any like angel stories before? Usually they're humongous, yes? So they probably need 4 feet by 4 feet. With their wings closed. Yeah? So imagine all the angels standing straight with the wings closed, yeah? Folded, 4 by 4, 100 billion angels. I calculate it and I figure out that you have to have an auditorium 3 times bigger than the earth. Ladies and gentlemen, what I'm trying to say is this. Imagine chapter 4, the throne of God and the angels. Chapter 5, who is able to open the book? Bam, the lamb that was slain. He is able to open the book. And the whole universe, the whole creation, all the angels, thousands upon thousands and thousands, 10,000 upon 10,000 angels, they are singing the song, saying with a loud voice, worthy is the lamb that was slain to receive power and riches and wisdom and strength and honor and glory and blessing. Can you imagine? Let your imagination go up high. This is what Book of Revelation is all about. Give you a glimpse of what heaven is like. Imagine we are going to be part of that choir someday. What do you say? I tell you, there is no glory on earth can match the glory that we're about to see in the kingdoms to come. Oh my. After this, then the seven seals. Jesus is about to open the seven seals. And what are they? Well, let me just give you a quick summary. Here we go. Or introduction. Seven seals. The first seal is about white horse. It's about victory. Second seal is about red horse. It's about war. Third seal is about black horse. It's about famine. Fourth seal is about pale horse. It's about death. And the fifth seal is about martyrs. Martyrs, okay? And then the sixth seal is about the seal of the living God. And then the seventh seal is about second coming. So what is the whole point of these seven seals? Listen, these seven seals have a very, very serious message. And that message is this, very simple. I know, you get all confused, you know, so you may even feel a little headache because the white horse, red horse, black horse, right? And you get a little dizzy, but don't get dizzy, ladies and gentlemen. Let's make it really simple. The seven seals have one final message. You know what that is? When you follow Jesus Christ, when you follow the truth, when you follow the word of God, there is a consequence. What consequence? There is a chance that you might have to give up your life for the truth that you believe. You see, my friends, the Bible is no joke. The Bible from the beginning until the end, we have series of people, numbers of people who are willing to die for the truth. Ladies and gentlemen, let me say it like this. If you are not ready to die for the truth, you are not ready to live for the truth. And if you're not ready to live for the truth, you are not ready to die for the truth. So, in this prophetic message of seven seals, God is just simply asking a question. Be willing to give up your life for the truth that you believe. Because, my friends, self-sacrifice for something, it is the greatest expression of how much you love that you die for. You understand? When you love something so much, you're willing to die for it. And for some reason, in the great cosmic conflict, God and Satan, during their great controversy, there is some requirement from certain people, not all, but certain people, that death is required. But the question is, are you willing? Do you love the truth so much that you're willing to give up your life? If not, you need to know the truth more and love the truth and Jesus more. So let's get into this. Let's find out some details about what is really going on here in the seven seals, all right? The first seal, the Bible says, and I saw when the Lamb opened one of the seals, and I heard as it were the noise of thunder, and one of the four beasts saying, come and see. And I saw, and behold, a what? White horse. And he that sat on him had a bow. So imagine bow. And crown was given unto him, and he went forth conquering and to conquer. So what is this white horse? What is this? This is kind of, it's like a fairy tale, right? Why is the Bible using this symbolic language of horse? Well, in the book of Zechariah, chapter 10, verse 3, the Bible says, the Bible gives us a clue of what a horse might represent. And it says, for the Lord of hosts has visited his flock of the house of what? Judah, and hath made them, meaning the house of Judah, made them as his what? Goodly horse in the battle. So in the Bible, my friends, horse, they do represent God's people. And whores, according to the Bible, it was used for war. So basically, horses revealing the fact that how God's people are going to go through what? Battles, conflicts. So seven seals is about the conflicts that the people of God have to go through. So it begins with the white horse. And you remember the bow that was mentioned? The bow? Very interesting. And I saw, and behold, a white horse. And he that sat on him had a what? Bow. So what does that bow represent? Well, what do you think? Well, let's find out. In the Old Testament, it says in Habakkuk chapter 3, verse 9, it says, thy bow was made quite naked according to the oath of the tribes, even thy what? Words. There you have connection between bow and the word of God. So you see, my friends, white horse, conquering to conquer, is very simple. In the beginning of the first century, after Jesus came, Christian movement was strong. It was as, and white also represents victory. So Christian church was having victorious experience. Why? Because they had the bow. And bow represents word of God. So with the word of God, they were conquering to conquer. So right after Jesus came, Christians were victorious because they were proclaiming the word of God. You see? That's the picture. But then that quickly changed to red horse. So the first one, white horse, victorine. But then let's go to the red horse. Now, what does a red horse represent? It says in the Bible, when he had opened the second seal, I heard the second beast say, come and see. And there went out another horse that was red, and power was given to him that sat up thereon to take peace from the earth, and that they should kill one another. And there was given unto him a great sword. Now, in this picture of red horse, the Bible says to take what? Peace from the earth. Now, what does that mean? Red, take peace from the earth. Now, I know this may be elementary, but you know, red in the Bible, many times it represents what? Blood. So we can imagine lots of shedding of blood here. And in Deuteronomy chapter 20, verse 12, the Bible says, and if it will make no what? Peace with thee, but will what? Make war against thee. So this, ladies and gentlemen, when the red horse is taking away peace, it's basically it's a war against God's people. And there is going to be much bloodshedding. And that's exactly what happened after the first century of the Christian movement. You remember do you remember the history? How Romans came and persecuted the Christians. There are a lot of bloodshedding were taking place. So second horse, red horse, war, persecution. But then he followed with the black horse. The Bible says when he had opened the third seal, I heard a third beast saying, come and see. And I beheld, and lo, a black horse. And he that sat on him had a pair of what? Balances in his hand. And what are these balances for? Back in those days, they used balances for what? What do you think? Balances, back in those days. What do you guys think? Balances. Who used balances back in those days? I think I'm hearing merchants. Yes. People are selling food, yeah? How about the local market here? Do they use balances? I know some years ago, the people were still using balances, right? Now, and then it says, and I heard a voice in the midst of the four beasts saying, a measure of wheat for a penny, three measures of barley for a penny. See thou heard not the oil and wine. So ladies and gentlemen, what do you usually do with wheat? You eat it, yes? As food. What about barley? It's food, okay. So a measure of wheat and a measure is usually how much you eat per person, okay? One person can eat one measure. So one measure of wheat for one person, for how much? penny, ooh, it's cheap. Maybe we should go shop at the Revelation store. Look, it's really cheap. It says 3 measures of barley for penny. Is that cheap? Cheap, right? Well, let's find out. Okay. In Matthew chapter 20, verse 2, it says, and when he had agreed with the laborers for a what? Penny a day. So what's a penny back in the Bible days? Penny represents how much a man can earn in one day. So can you imagine, you work all day long, 8 hours, 10 hours, and whatever money you got, you get from that, you can only buy one meal. Or most, if you buy barley, 3 meals. So you work all day and you can only survive that very day. Is that a good deal or bad deal? That's really expensive. So ladies and gentlemen, what makes food price go up? And please don't say America. What makes food price go up? What makes sugarcane price go up? If there's a lack of sugarcane, exactly. So this expression is saying there's not much wheat, not much barley. Yeah? Do you remember Genesis chapter 18, verse 6? Abraham hastened into the tent unto Sarah and said, make ready quickly 3 measures of fine meal. You remember the 3 guests that came? Yeah, so Abraham says, make 3 measures of meal. Again, 1 measure is good for 1 meal. So it's really expensive. So what's going on? Ladies and gentlemen, black horse is representing famine. But what kind of famine? According to the Bible, Jesus says, I am the bread of life. Yes? So wheat and barley, that's what they used back in those days to make bread. And symbolically speaking, bread represents the word of God. So the famine represents lack of word of God. And that's exactly what happened. After the persecution of Roman Empire by the pagans, there was a great compromise between Christians and the pagans. And because of that, people are not understanding the word of God, and people are not really preaching the word of God, and there are a lot of false teachings, false doctrines coming in, and this created, so to speak, famine of the word of God. So as you can see, in the beginning was a white horse, but then it's getting worse. The battle, and then compromise, the famine, and the next horse follows. And when he had opened the fourth seal, I heard the voice of the fourth beast say, come and see. And I looked, and behold, a pale horse. His name that sat on him was death, and hell followed with him. And power was given unto them over the fourth part of the earth to kill with sword and with hunger and with death and with the beasts of the earth. Notice, regarding the fourth horseman, he is using what the red horse used. Yes or no? Remember the red horse was using the sword? He's using the sword. You remember the black horse? Famine, meaning hunger, yes? And he's using the same thing. So what is this pale horse? Pale horse is a mixture of red horse and black horse. I know. I'm not trying to say you mix red color and black color, you get a pale. I'm not trying to say that. I know what I'm talking about because I know about art, okay? But that's not what the Bible is trying to say. But symbolically speaking, okay, because he has all the characteristics of the red horse and the black horse, pale horse is a mixture of pagan Roman Empire with paganism compromised with Christianity. So the pale horse represents a time period when, basically, make things really simple, when pagan practices were compromised with Christian teachings. At the same time, these people that who uphold pagan ideas and Christian teachings, they were persecuting, killing the faithful Christians and the followers of God. So that's the reason why it used the term death. So God is saying, listen, my children. So Jesus is saying, listen, my children, you will go through this kind of conditions in the world. You will be persecuted, and the word of God will be taken away, and they will come and try to kill you. But stay faithful. Hold on. Why? Remember Jesus, he presented himself as who? Lamb that was what? Slain. What does that mean? He is resurrected. Because Jesus got resurrected, therefore, should we fear death? No. You see, my friends, fear of death is a deadly motivation that gives so much stress to so many people in the world today. When you become a Christian, you really need to develop the sense, the emotional feeling, the faith, the fortitude, and your focus on God is so strong that you do not have a fear of death. Not that you become reckless, not that you become careless. No, you are careful, you are responsible. However, your whole life is not moved by, what if I'm going to die? I don't want to die. No. Yes, you want to stay healthy, strong, eat good, and keep up with good health. But my friends, don't be like so many people who are driven by surviving, surviving. I got to survive. Listen, you can do all the surviving that you want to do. Eventually, you're going to die. Yes or no? So don't pay attention to surviving. Do what you can, but pay attention to higher things that God is trying to say. So these seven, so when you listen to Book of Revelation, seven seals, what are you imagining? Ooh, seals, secret message. Maybe there's some messages that will tell us how bad the governments are or how bad these institutions are. Yes, it may have some of that, but the deeper issue is this. Seven seals? Fear not death. Even though the world will come and destroy you, because I am your Savior, Jesus said. I am the one that can give you life and resurrection. Believe in him. However, as we continue with the seals, and when he had opened the fifth seal, I saw under the altar the souls of them that were what? Slain for the word of God and for the testimony which they held. There you go. I thought about it. I really thought about it. Giving up my life for the word of God. I heard these stories of these terrorists coming to a town, enter into a church, and then they ask the church members to stand against the wall. And they have only two choices. Spit on the Bible and live, or get a bullet and die. Two choices. Spit on the Bible or get a bullet and die. Which one would you choose? Which one? And some of these stories, my friends, you like to hear miracle story, huh? And then the terrorist, he pulled the trigger, but then it was jammed. The gun was not working. Oh, there was a shot, but then there was no bullet. No, there are some stories, the people actually died. I know when you hear like a miracle story, I'm sure the miracle will happen for me. Yeah? Do you ever imagine, oh, in the last days, when they come and capture me and put me, maybe they're going to burn me. Oh, I'm ready for that day. I'm going to tell those people, the fire is not hot enough. Put some more wood. I'm going to tell them that. And then I'm going to sing the song, Almighty Fortress is our God. Do you ever imagine? Yeah, or I will sing the song, Blessed Assurance. Sing a song like, as you're singing, you're burning. Like, oh, you imagine, you're having Disneyland imagination. end time. Okay? That will never happen unless. That will never happen unless you do what the Bible is about to tell you. But as you can see clearly, can you see what's going on? The white horse, red horse, black horse, pale horse. Basically, you are going to die. That's what God is saying. I'm sorry. You like to hear God says, I will give you a bigger house. I will make your bank account fatter. Yeah, you like to hear that, right? But no, the Bible is pretty, the truth is plain. You're going to die. And then the Bible says, there are people under the altar, slain for the word of God. And then the Bible says, and they what? Cry with a what? Loud voice saying, how long, O Lord, holy and true, dost thou not judge and avenge our blood on them that dwell on the earth? Now, wait a minute. Oh, the Bible says, are these people dead or alive? Are they dead or alive? Come on. The Bible said they were slain, yes? That means they are dead. But the Bible says they are what? Crying. So dead people can cry? I don't know about you, but if we take that literally, that's a scary verse. If there's a ghost verse, it's one right here. They're crying. This is what you imagine? I don't know about the Filipinos, but the Koreans, they have terrible ghost stories. The worst ghost story, you know what it is? Especially when a long time ago when Korea used to have their outhouse toilet outside. Yeah? And the worst ghost story is the ghosts in the toilet. The hen will come up and oh, I was so scared. You just want to do it quickly and you come out. And you wipe later, I'm just kidding. But I don't know how, do you believe in ghosts? If you read the Bible text like this, like, wait a minute, they're all crying? Listen. This is a symbolic expression. What did I say? Symbolic. Now, how do I know it's a symbolic expression? Here's how. There's a Bible text, a story about Cain and Abel. Okay, in Genesis chapter 4, verse 10, and you know the story how Cain killed Abel, okay? And it says, and he said, what hast thou done? The voice of thy brother's what? Blood crieth unto me from the ground. You see, it's an expression of God. God has a great sympathy for those who die for his truth. Therefore, it is as though, even though they are dead and they cannot speak, but it is as though he is hearing their cries. You with me? Okay? Because it is important, ladies and gentlemen, it is very important for us to know that what happens to us when we die. In fact, in the last days, I don't have time to go into all the details, but in the last days, one of the major deceptions is going to be spiritualism. Spiritualism simply means, you know, your loved ones who passed away, they come back to you. But your loved ones are not coming back to you. They are demons in human forms that look just like your father, mother, sister, brother, uncle, auntie, and friends. And when they come to you, they're not going to come to you with blood dripping down, you know, like a horn on their head, fang, you know, with the long nails, long hair with the white gown. No, they're not going to come to you like that. If they come to you like that, what are you going to do? Oh, Lord Jesus, save me, right? Devil is not that dumb. In fact, he's so smart, he makes things, something that is not there, really scary, so that when he brings his deception, you'll be easily deceived. When he comes to you, he will come to you just like flesh and blood form. All clean and nice smiles. What kind of smile? Buccalo smile. And they're going to smell good. Their eyes going to sparkle with love and gentleness. And they stand before you. You think I'm joking? I know a pastor, a really good pastor. He passed away now. But I know a pastor, very faithful pastor. He lost his son during Vietnam War. He was so sad. He was heartbroken. He wants to see his son back. But he knows his son is dead. But then one night, according to him, he saw his son standing at the end of his bed in real flesh and blood. Looked just like his son. And the pastor, at initial second, my son, you know that feeling, you know, it's understandable. Oh, my son, right? But then he quickly realized that's not his son. So he said, in the name of Jesus Christ, get out of here. And that image was gone, just like that. But don't be deceived. This is important because, my friends, check this out. In 1 John chapter 3, verse 12, the Bible says, not as Cain, who was that of the wicked one, slew his brother, and wherefore slew he him? Because his own works were evil and his brother righteous. Basically, this text is saying, Cain, who says he worships God, but then he ended up killing his brother. Because the brother's works rebuked the works of Cain. So basically, for Cain, Abel made him feel guilty because not following God. And that caused him to get angry and mad and killed him. But then, let's talk a little more about this. What happened to us when we die? In verse 11, the Bible says, and white robes were given unto every one of them, meaning those that died, okay? And it was said unto them that they should what? Rest yet for a little season. Rest until their fellow servants also and their brethren that should be what? Killed as they were should be fulfilled. So, those that are died, God is saying, because you die for the word of God, there is a white raiment provided for you, meaning you're saved. But you have to take a little what? Rest. Until your fellow brothers and your fellow servants, they also get killed. Oh, what a sad message, but it's the reality. It's in seven seals. It's about death. I know, it's a serious topic. Look, listen, so what does that mean, rest? So I searched, they should rest for a little season. What does that mean? In Matthew chapter 26, verse 45, then cometh he to his disciples, saith unto them, sleep on now and take your what? So basically rest, meaning sleep, okay? And what does that mean, sleep, symbolically speaking? In John 11, verse 13, howbeit Jesus spake of his death, but they thought that he has spoken of taking of what? Rest and sleep. So there is a biblical expression. When somebody dies or somebody is dead, the Bible says he is sleeping. He is taking a rest. Let me show you. 1 Kings chapter 2, verse 10. So David, what did he do? Slept with his fathers and what? Buried in the city of David. Now, when the Bible says slept, do you think that's just like a literal taking a nap? Would you bury somebody who's taking a nap? Oh, mommy's taking a nap. Let's bury her. Would you do that? No. So the Bible actually says David is dead, but instead of David is dead, he is what? Sleeping. Look at that. Okay. Men and brethren, let me freely speak unto you of a patriarch David, that he is both what? Dead and buried. There you go. Even the Bible says he is dead and buried. And at the same time, the Bible says he is sleeping. So then, if you are sleeping, what does that mean? I'm glad the Bible used the term sleeping to describe death. You know why? Because, my friend, if the Bible says death is death, then there's no hope. But because the Bible says death is like sleeping, there's a hope. What hope? If you're sleeping, there should be a time that you are going to what? Wake up. Exactly. And that's exactly what the Bible says in John chapter 5, verse 28. Marvel not at this, for the hour is coming in the which all that are in the graves shall hear his voice. Where are they? In the graves. Now, wait a minute. Some people say, when you die, you go up to heaven right away. But the Bible says they will hear his voice where? In graves. So if you say if they went to heaven right away, that means they have to come back down right away to go back in the grave and to hear his... It doesn't make any sense. How is that? What do you believe? You believe when somebody dies, he goes to heaven right away? Or go to hell right away? Or just simply, according to the Bible, they are sleeping. Wait for the resurrection to be saved, or resurrection of condemnation, according to John chapter 5. So in order for us to understand about this death, we need to understand something about life. So in the Bible, Genesis chapter 2 verse 7, the Bible says, and the Lord God formed man of the dust of the ground, and breathed into his nostrils the what? Breath of life, and man became a living soul. Now, so what is life? Life is dust plus breath equals soul. That's it. All right. And breath in the Bible, all the while my breath is in me and the Spirit of God is in my nostrils. So really, when the Bible says breath of God, it's really talking about the Spirit of God. Okay. So therefore, breath, let's change that to spirit. And dust is what God used to make the body. So body plus spirit is, when you put them together, you have life. When you have a body alone, there is no life. If you have a spirit alone, there is no life. You gotta what? Put them together in order to have a life. You might thinking, spirit itself is a life. I understand. It is life source. But spirit without body, it is not a conversational living being. It is a source of life that came from God. Okay? So then, what is death? Death, the Bible says, for as the body without the spirit is what? Dead. So body minus spirit is death. All right? So then, just like this, in order to have light, okay, let's say that light is like life. In order to have light, what do you have to have? You gotta have a light bulb, yes? That's the body. And then you have to have electricity or power. When you put them together, you have light. Can you have light just with bulb? No. Can you have light if you have power, electricity? You have light just with electricity? No, not really, right? You gotta have them both. In a similar way, you have to have both. So what happens after I die? What happens? According to the Bible, Ecclesiastes chapter 12, verse 7, it says, then shall the dust return to the what? Earth as it was. And the spirit shall what? Return unto God. According to the Bible, spirit, the Bible says, God, when God was creating Adam, God what? Breathed into his nostrils the breath of God. But when you die, what happens to that breath, the spirit? It goes back to God. So when it goes back to God, it goes back to where? It goes back to where? Since it came out of his mouth, it will go back to his mouth, so to speak. If I have to make it imaginary, I have to say it like this. Because according to the Bible, it goes back to where it came, yes? So don't imagine spirit without the body goes back to God, and spirit somehow, like a foggy or little invisible looking floating spirit, like having conversation with God without the body. No. 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 According to the Bible, you have to have body plus spirit in order to have life. Okay? So, Ecclesiastes chapter 9, verse 5, the Bible says, "For the living know that they shall what?" Do we have any living people here tonight? Okay, according to the Bible, you may not know a lot of things, but there's one thing that you do know. You're going to die. And the Bible says, "But the dead know not what? Anything, neither have they any more reward, or the memory of them is forgotten." So dead people, do they know anything? No. Can they speak? No. Do they have any emotions? No, they're dead. So just in case, okay, just in case, if there is like a ghost figure comes to you, "Oh, I come to you. I remember what you have done to me before." If the ghost speaks to you like that, say it like this. Then this is how you should respond. You should say, "According to Ecclesiastes chapter 9, verse 5, dead know not anything." Amen? Yeah, so just ignore them. Ignore those dumb ghosts, okay? I mean, what are they going to do? They're going to eat you, what? Turn you into a hamburger or something? No, they cannot do anything. Satan, evil angels are trying to frighten you. So don't believe that. And then he will come back to you with demon that looks just like your loved ones. That is not scary. So even Satans have good cop and bad cop, okay? So don't fall for the trick. Now, so then according to the Bible, "But man dieth and wastes away, yea, man give up the ghost. Where is he?" Now again, don't get confused. When the Bible says ghost, it simply means spirit. So after he is dead, where is he? And the Bible says, "So man lieth down and rise not." See that? Lieth down, it's like sleeping. Rise up, it's like you're awake. "So you will not rise up until when? Heavens be no more. They shall not awake nor raise out of their" what? Sleep. See that? So you will not be resurrected until when? Until when? According to the Bible, until when? Heavens be no more, when heaven passes away. So you are not going to get up until heaven passes away. So what does it mean when the Bible says heaven passes away? 2 Peter chapter 3 verse 10, the Bible says, "But the day of the Lord will come." What day? Day of the Lord. What is it talking about? Second coming. But the day of the Lord will come as a thief in the night, in the which the heavens shall what? So the Bible says you will die and rise out again. If you believe in God, you will not awake again out of your sleep until heavens pass away. And according to the Bible, heaven shall pass away when Jesus come. Exactly. So therefore, you will not be resurrected until Jesus comes back. Okay? So we are looking forward to that day. According to Daniel chapter 12, verse 2, the Bible says, "And many of them that sleep in the dust of the earth shall awake, some to everlasting life and some to shame and everlasting contempt." So ladies and gentlemen, that's what we are waiting for at the second coming of Jesus, that there will be a resurrection of life. I'm telling you, that is going to be a great day. So then the question is, how can we meet? All right, so God made it very clear, you have to face death. Now you know what's going to happen to you when you're dead. It's like you're sleeping. But then now the question is, who can be resurrected with the resurrection of life? Who? Philippians chapter 3 verse 9, "And be found in him, not having my own righteousness, which is of the law, but that which is through the faith of Christ, the righteousness which is of God by faith, that I may know him," listen, "and the power of his resurrection, and the fellowship of his sufferings, being made conformable unto his death, if by any means I might attain unto the resurrection of the dead. Let's make it simple. How to be part of the resurrection of the dead, or resurrection of life for the righteous, according to the Bible, you have to experience righteousness by faith. But notice, within the righteousness by faith experience, okay, it says, being made conformable unto his death. What does that mean, being made conformable? What does that mean? It just simply means this. You die like Jesus. If you die like Jesus, you will be resurrected like Christ. When Jesus got resurrected, remember, he's called the first begotten of the dead, first begotten. So anybody who wants to be part of that, you have to die like Jesus so that you can be resurrected like Jesus. So, how to prepare yourself? Now, there's a chance that you can see Jesus coming in the clouds of heaven without seeing death. However, that's for the very last day people. But for all of us, really, you want to be ready for the resurrection of life. How? It's the way you're going to die. How are you going to die? It will determine how you will be resurrected. Let me show you what the Bible says. For if we have been what? Planted together in the likeness of his death, we shall be also in the likeness of his. You see that? The word planted is used, what actions, what activities planted? Seeds, right? Seeds. Yeah, what do you do with the seeds? You bury them. Ah, the burial. The burial, if you're planted together in the likeness of his death, if you die like Jesus, then you'll be resurrected like Jesus. So then, really, your life is about preparing yourself to die. I know that sounds really sad and morbid, right? But let me put it this way to you. Listen. According to the Bible, you can actually practice death every day. You can actually practice death every day. In fact, the only way to overcome the fear of death is to practice dying with Jesus every day. You cannot overcome the fear of death just by, making your chest bigger and then, lift up your chin higher and hold your arms stronger and says, I fear no death. That's not going to help you. What can help you is, according to the Bible, if you learn to give your life to God in a similar manner of dying to self, crucifying yourself with Jesus every day. When you do it every day, you repeat every day, surrender. You repeat every day, not my will. You repeat every day, not my desire. You repeat every day, not my ways. If you repeat every day, this kind of I die daily. Whatever you repeat, it becomes habit. And your habit is going to be your character. Therefore, when time comes for you to give up your life, whether it's a natural death or somebody will come kill you, it is going to be automatically natural thing for you to just surrender. Do you understand? But if you always live your life like don't put me down, or don't push me, or I'm going to get you, okay? I'm going to be better than you. You cannot, You cannot treat me that way. You're always fighting fighting for your image, fighting for yourself, fighting for your pride, fighting for your ideas, your ego, your characteristic. Sometimes you are very nasty, but you don't admit. You just want to blame other people. It's because of you, your wife, because of you, your husband, because of you, your children. You want to blame other people and you just live like that? It's like you want to kill other people, but you don't kill yourself. If you constantly live your life like that, when time comes for you to give up your life, you will not give up your life. If there's a gun, you will shoot the other guy. So it's the idea of, listen, that's why Romans chapter 6, verse 6, the Bible says, knowing this, that our what? Old man is what? Crucified with him, that the body of sin might be destroyed, that henceforth we should not what? Serve sin. So what needs to die every day? What needs to die every day? Old man. When the Bible says old man, who is that? Please don't look to your husband. So every day the Bible says the old man must be crucified. What is that? Who is that old man? It's you. But what is it? According to the Bible, it says our old man is crucified with him, that the body of what? Body of sin. Now wait a minute. Body of sin. What body? This body? This arm and this chest and this leg, these legs? What body? Now let's go a little deeper. Body of sin might be destroyed, that henceforth we should not what? Serve sin. Listen to me. Serve sin. If I'm serving sin, what am I? If I'm serving sin, I am what? If I'm serving sin, what am I? Servant. And sin is my master. So old man is the body of sin, and I serve sin. See, old man is master. You understand? So old man represents sin. At the same time, it's not just any sin. Sin that acts like master. So sin that you have in your life that is like a master may not be same as sin that you have in your life as a master. Let me explain. It is true, we have to crucify every sin. That is true. However, what we have to think more carefully is, especially sins that has master over us. What does that mean? It means this. What is a relationship between master and servant? If a master comes out and then says to the servants, go outside, go to the field and work. The servants, how do they respond? What do they say? Do they say, hey man, today is too hot. Why don't you go work? I don't feel like it. Back in those days, you think that's how they responded to the master? How did they respond? Come on, you kind of act it out. What did they usually say? Yes, sir. So they, at a moment of a command, a moment of that command, the servant automatically, without even thinking about it, what? Obey. Yes or no? So the question is, what sin do you have in your life that you automatically, without even thinking about it, obey? Whatever sin that sin is your master. Are you following? And how do we have this kind of sin? Very simple. Whatever you repeat, it becomes habit. habit. And your habit, what is habit? Habit is something that you do automatically without thinking about it. You with me? Automatically without thinking about it. Therefore, when the Bible says our old man should be crucified, we are talking about sins that you have repeated so long you do it automatically. That particular sin, you need to let Jesus crucify it. Are you understanding this? Why? You're like, oh, this is so hard. Why do we have to give up that? You know why? Listen. In your heart, you can only have one love. The Bible says you cannot love God and love yourself or sin at the same time. Here's the reason why. Do you know why people like to repeat? Do it again. You know why? Because they love it. So the sin that has a master over you, that's because you love that sin. So the Bible says the old man that you love must be crucified. Why? You cannot have two masters. You cannot have two loves. Only one love. How is that possible? Very possible. How? Some people, when they hear this, you know what they do? This is what they do. Oh, I have to give up my cherished idol, my secret sin, the sin that I love. I gotta give that up. Okay, I'm gonna give up. When I go home, I'm gonna change my life and I'm gonna just fight it. Ladies and gentlemen, if you do that, you are going to fail. Completely fail. And you'll be disappointed, discouraged, and give up. And maybe 3 months later, you'll be like, nobody can be perfect. All the church members, same. We'll go to heaven somehow. And you give up. Don't do it that way. It's a trap. How do you kill this old man? The Bible says you must what? Crucified with him. You know what that means? Very simple. Whatever problem that you have that you feel really guilty and you want to overcome, bring that problem, that sin, at the foot of the cross. In your mind, somehow behold Jesus dying on the cross. Read about it. Yes, I know. Sounds too simple. No. Read in the Bible. Meditate upon the death of Jesus. Just stay right there. Let your mind grasp the suffering and the pain that Jesus is going through as he is dying for your sin on the cross. If you haven't had this kind of experience, you don't know what I'm talking about. You have to have it. Many of you, I tried Christianity, but it's not for me. You know what you're saying? You're really saying, I try to be good on my own, but I cannot. That's what you're saying. Or, I tried Christianity. You know what you're saying? I was expecting everybody to love me and be kind, but they cannot, therefore I cannot. It's an excuse. You understand? It's an excuse. You have to have your personal, intimate experience. What experience? Somehow, you're on your knees. You open the Bible, reading about the death of Jesus. My God, why has thou forsaken me? Forgive them, for they know not what they do. Read, meditate, think, pray. This is what's going to happen. When you pray, even though you love your sin, and when you love something, that's emotional level of human being. And it's easier to change your thinking, but not your feeling. Feeling changing is almost impossible. How do you change your feeling? That's the reason why Jesus says, come to me, behold me. So when you behold Jesus on the cross dying, somehow beholding the love of Christ will change your heart. That which you love, you begin to hate. Only the cross can change your emotional feeling about things in the world. That's the only way. That's the reason why the Bible says we are crucified with him. So don't try to kill him. And that's the reason why in Galatians chapter 2, verse 20, I am crucified with Christ. That is the only way, only at the cross, you can have new feelings and new thoughts. And it became, and at the same time, it becomes heart transforming power in your life. So then that moment, what do? When you feel that change, when you feel that love of God coming to you, you know what you need to do? You just make one decision. You do have to make a decision. What decision? I surrender what I love. Bam, just like that. Why? See, we were already told in the book of Genesis, Abraham. Yeah, when Abraham, he didn't pass the test, God says, Abraham, give up your son. So in order for Abraham to express his faith and love for God, he needed to give up the something that he loved the best. And we have to have a similar experience. So tonight, in your own conscience, nobody needs to see your conscience, in the dark corners of your mind, in the secret chambers of your conscience, is there anything in your life, in your mind, in your conscience that you love more than God? Jesus said, that needs to die today. You have two choices. You can kill that sin today, or when you die with sin. You don't want to die with sin. You want to kill sin before you die. Why? You gotta kill your sin with Jesus before you die in order for you to be resurrected like Jesus. What will take away fear of death? When you give all your sins to Jesus. That's what these prophecies are saying. If you believe in Jesus, you're gonna die soon. For some, you may have to give up your life. However, the only way to get ready, you have to die with Jesus every day. So you're like, I have to crucify myself? What does that mean? I have to kill myself. Listen, have you seen a dead person before? Have you seen a dead person? I'm sure you have. When you, by faith, crucify yourself, surrender yourself, it is as though you consider yourself dead, according to the Bible. What does that mean? If there's a dead body right here, if I come to the dead body and I say, you are the most ugly person I ever seen in my life, what do you think the dead person will do? Get up and say, hey, why do you talk to me like that? If I come to the dead person, hey, here's a nice drug. It's the latest drug from America. Hey, try out. Here. What do you think the dead person will do? Get up and say, hey, thanks, man. Yeah, I go up to the dead person. I kick the dead person. Punch the dead person. Spit on the dead person. What do you think the dead person will do? Nothing, because he is dead. The Bible says, consider yourself as dead. That's what the Bible says. When you die, you don't know anything. You are dead. But you're thinking, no, but Brother Gregory, but we can see, we can feel. If people punch me, ouch. Dead person, he doesn't know. So you're like, I feel the temptation. I feel the temptation. That's why the Bible says faith is not sight. We don't walk by sight. We don't walk by senses. We walk by faith. So by faith, even though we can feel temptation, you consider them dead. Consider yourself dead. And you are alive to God. Your old man is dead, but you are alive. That means you choose new thoughts and new feelings, and you put actions to it. One time I was studying in Christian college. Another Korean young man, different young man. There was a younger Korean young man. But this young man, he is a professional in making people feel bad. Do you know anybody like that? Ooh, professional. They know how to just say the words in such a way to put the pin right at the weak point. But they do it in such a way that they're all holy and, you know, high. They're so good at it. And you can't even really fight back because you're a Christian. Right? So there's a young man like that. I don't like him. Yeah? If he comes this way, I'm going this way. If he is sitting right next to me and having his meal, if I have to eat my food next to him, I think I will have an indigestion. Honestly, if God was not looking at me for just 3 seconds, that's all I need. If God was not looking at me for 3 seconds, I would just, But I cannot do that. Why? I'm at a Christian college. I'm studying Bible. But in my heart, I hate him. So I pray. One night I was praying, oh God, you know the ceremonial prayer? Oh God, thank you so much for today, for the health, for the teachers, for the school, for the weather, for this, for the family, da 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 da. And I want to say, in the name of Jesus, amen. I want to say that. Before I want to say that, I hear the voice. Peter, what about your brother? And I knew exactly which brother God was talking about. But I don't want to pray about him. I don't want to pray about that brother. You know why? If I pray about him, I have to love him. I don't want to love him. In the name of Jesus, amen. Next day, next night, I'm praying. Oh God, thank you so much for today, for the water, for sunshine, for the food, the teachers, friends, da da da. I want to say in the name of Jesus, Peter, how about that brother? In the name of Jesus, amen. Just go to bed, go to bed. Sleep, sleep, sleep. Forget about it, forget about it. I wake up in the morning. Here I am, Christian, wanting to do morning devotion. When I open the Bible, when I read, it sounds like this. Peter, how about that brother? Here I am praying for my food, my cereal, crunchy cereal. Peter, how about the brother? I go to worship service. You know, somebody is preaching about some Old Testament or New Testament, but it sounds like, how about the brother, Peter? Here I am walking in nature. Birds are singing. I don't hear them. Flowers are beautiful. I don't see them. How about the brother, Peter? And one time I was walking, long road. But from far distance, I see somebody coming. It's that brother. You know what that means? We have to pass each other. So I looked to my left, looked to my right, if I can find any escape route. No escape route. I have to walk by him. And here I am walking by him. And when we come close, we don't say anything to each other. Can you imagine? You're like 3 feet away from him. 3 feet away from him. And there's nobody else. We walk as though we didn't see each other. Can you imagine? But when I walk by, I can hear the voice. It's an impression. Peter, how about this brother? Do you want to see him in heaven? 6 months later, God is long-suffering, amen? I came to God. One day, I said, okay, God, I'll be honest. I hate him. I can almost feel God is saying, I know. You hate him, I know. It's obvious. God, I try to love him. I try to be nice. But when I look back, it's like, I try to love you with condition. You know, if you give me any dirty look, you're finished. That's the way I said I loved him. Right? So I try, oh God, I try to love him, but my love for him is all dried up. It's empty. I cannot love him. I have no feelings for him. In fact, you know, he's not a good student. He's lazy. No good. He's not even spiritual. He's not even spiritual. God says, Peter, love him. How? Love is not a feeling, it's principle. God, forgive me. I'm so sorry. Please help me. Help me to love him by choice with your help. Next morning, I'm going to the cafeteria. From the distance, I see my brother coming. As soon as I see his face, ugh. My old man shouting, my old man, don't talk to him. He doesn't like you. He doesn't deserve you. Avoid him. Don't talk to him. But here I am. My feeling for him, it's not like, you know, I see him like, oh, I love him now. No, I see him, I don't like him. My old man, don't talk to him. Don't talk to him. Don't talk to him. But I put forth into action. God, help me. I'm walking towards him. When I walk, no feelings. I keep walking. God, help me. And then my experience was, not I, but Christ. Not I, but Christ. Please help me. And I go, God, please help me to smile by faith. Have you tried that before? You're trying to smile, like, and if you smile, if you don't have a feeling, it hurts right here. You have to get yourself facial massage later. Yeah? I'm trying to smile, and it's not working. There's no feeling. Not I, but Christ. That's the only thing I had. Not I, but Christ. And I said to him, good morning, brother. I reached my hand just like that. And my friend, at first, he's like, what's going on? And he reached out his hand. As soon as I touched him, only when I touched his hand, the feelings of love came over me. And I began to have a different perspective about him. I began to have sympathy towards him. A sympathy. And then right away, we begin to have a better feeling. Right away. And God was changing my feelings for him, and he is changing too. And we became a better friend. What do you say? And then one day I talked to him. I said, hey friend, I want to ask you something. You know, before, not now, before, why did you used to bother me so much? Why did you treat me so bad? You know what he said? Peter, because you're better than me. I was jealous. And this man, he's a kind of big man too. He began to cry. And he said, Peter, I want to be saved. I cried. I hugged him. I remember, it's in the tiny hallway, the stairs going up, and there we're holding each other, praying for each other, with tears coming out. And that happened because God helped me. to say, not I, but Christ. My old man dead. Only Christ lives in me. Because of that, I was able to restore a brother. After that, our relationship is good. Respect, honor, understanding, harmony. Do you understand? Listen, I know we're talking about seven seals. Christians are going to die. Martyrs, yes. Maybe you think about you have to die for Christ. But listen, don't even worry about that. What you have to worry about today, are you willing to die? Meaning, are you willing to surrender your selfish thoughts and feelings so that you can express more love and truth to your brothers and sisters? Would you die daily for your family, for your husband, for your wife, for your children? When I became father, three children, there are times, you know, especially with my voice. But there are moments I have to, not I, but Christ. And then I turn to gentle, loving, understanding, and soft. And that works. It works. It brings growth, harmony, and love, sweet spirit. God is good, amen? So that's what we're talking about tonight, righteousness by faith, that you're made to die like Jesus. So how did Jesus die? Forgive them, for they know not what they do. He died basically saying, God, I commit my spirit into your hands. That's what we need to experience every day. So question here tonight is, how many of you, you're willing? Tonight, start making that important decision. Tonight, oh God, I identify my master sin. But tonight is a night, oh Jesus, help me to take my master sin and crucify him. I want that tonight. Is that what you want? Is that something that you want to have in your life tonight? I know you struggle. God knows. I know it's so difficult. God understands. But you have to start making your decision, even though you may fail, but you have to repeat the making same decision over and over again. What decision? Not I, but Christ. That you may experience the newness of life. God will not give you a new body unless you have the new mind of Jesus Christ. Let this mind be in you, which was also in Jesus Christ. Do you understand? So is there anyone here tonight? God has impressed you. I don't want the mediocre ones. I want the worst ones tonight. The mediocre ones, those are doing pretty okay Christian-wise, you sit back. But I want the worst ones. If you are those worst ones with the worst sin master issue, that you want to give Jesus an opportunity to give you new life, please stand and come to the front. I want to have a special prayer with you. God bless you, man. God bless you, young man. God bless you. Anyone else? I'm calling the worst ones. Please come. Come close. Let's pray together that God will help us. Whatever it might be. And you don't have to share it with anyone else. You can only tell God, and God knows. Or is it something that is a hatred against someone? Maybe you have to confess to that particular person. Come closer. There are other people coming behind you. Come closer. Tonight is a special night, because tomorrow night we're going to get into even more. We're going to get into a deeper stuff tomorrow night. So please don't miss tomorrow night. It's so important. But tonight is a night that we need to come to the foot of the cross. Amen? God bless you. I see many of you. You're not coming to the front because we already have so many people. God bless you for coming and standing for Jesus tonight. And ladies and gentlemen, yes, realistically speaking, none of us are perfect. We're not compete to see who's better than other people. We stand before God and God alone, amen? And God has plenty patience and grace and mercy for our problem. But there's one thing that we do have to believe and make choice, and that is in Christ, all things are possible. Amen? Start dreaming new life. Start thinking about new thoughts. Start by choice feeling the new feelings by faith, and God will restore you. I know the way you grew up, way I grew up. If I talk about the way I grew up, man, dysfunctional family. Let me tell you, our family, dysfunctional, completely dysfunctional. Yeah, I come from family where it's a perfect case, perfect situation to produce criminal. Yeah, and I could have been, I guess I was a little gangster before, but I could have been like worse. But only God can give that hope. It starts with a spark, but then it burns with desire. And you can have that tonight. Yeah. This is not an emotional high. This may not be like the Pentecostal, but this is what I call gentle, sweet, early rain. In that sense, Pentecostal. A rain that softens your heart, that you become calm, reasonable, and you meditate, you think things through, and after all that, you smile, because in Christ, all things are possible. Let us pray. Gracious, loving Heavenly Father, we thank you so much for revealing the truth from the Bible. You are saying, whether by natural or by martyrdom, all God's people have to die, except the very, very special ones at the end who are not going to face any death. So tonight, I'm sure none of us are really ready to die. So thank you so much for giving us life. Thank you so much for giving us opportunity to accept you as our personal Savior. So tonight, we want to prepare for our future death by dying with you today, so that we can live the life of Christ today. So Lord, any sin that we have in our life right now that has a master over us, it controls us, it chains us, and then it gives us discouragement, disappointment, guilty feeling, fears, and confusion. Tonight, free us. Deliver us. Give us the light of the hope of the glory of God. So tonight we come before you just as we are. And we are not claiming that we're going to be better today or tomorrow. We do not want to claim what we can do, but we want to claim what you can do. So teach us to look to you, the loving Savior, dying on the cross, until our hearts are melted and our thoughts and feelings are changed to love you more. So please, please be with us tonight. Give us that special, special experience. And we will repeat and repeat and repeat and repeat and repeat until we experience the love and the glory of God. We thank you. And we want to love you more. We ask all these things in the name of Jesus. Amen.